Okay. We don't have any adjustments, do we, Dave?
We do not, no.
And we do have a public comment section here for a couple minutes. If anybody's got something, it's a real issue to speak up.
So I'm getting a little bit of a little bit of feedback. So I'm going to mute everybody, and then the select board, if you could unmute yourselves. Okay. Gordon, you want to? Can you unmute? There you go.
I did.
Okay.
Okay, I don't hear any public, so I think we can get right on with the budget presentation.
Okay. Gordon, just you may want to. I'll just remind you and the board, anyways, that we have a Merrick Campbell fund request to talk about at the end, and then just for everyone else. That's participating, that we talk about that outside of the public due to sensitive social issues. But I just wanted to put that out there, Gordon.
Yeah, I got it on the list.
Okay. So fiscal year 22 budget. Proposed budget is what we're talking about. This has been difficult to kind of put together, working from home and trying to put together some sort of a presentation. I'm going to give it a go. I'm going to share my screen and budget information on the screen. I've asked Doug to kind of keep an eye on the list of people in case anybody's coming in. But I did relax the settings so that you don't need to wait in the lobby, just because once I start sharing the screen, I can't see anything other than really my desktop and the file that I'm sharing. So it's difficult for me to kind of run the meeting. So I've asked Doug to kind of keep an eye on, but hopefully.
And all set, Dave.
You're all set?
Yep.
People should be able to come and go. Without too much interference here. So I'm going to start not with the numbers, but I'm just going to start with where we've been in the past 3 to 4 years, just kind of give an overview of what the direction it has been and kind of what the concept is with this budget. Can everybody see this okay? I'll take that as a yes.
Yes.
Thank you, Mary. So I'm going into my fourth budget, and I'm going back to the fiscal year 18 budget and prior was before me. I'm going to spend a little bit of time talking about that, and I'm going to bring some things up. It's not to point out anything other than, you know, what we're building off of. You know, it's just, again, pointing things out. The budgets prior, and the one that we had in fiscal year 18, at the time, there was no legal expenses built into that budget. There was no IT expenses. Building maintenance was very low, $1,000 to $2,000 per building. I think that fiscal year we had like $15,000 worth of maintenance to the library alone. We had kind of small amounts for capital improvements. Going into this year, we had cut the buildings and grounds position. In the highway department, we were running at about $80,000 for paving. We have been doing that for, I don't know, maybe 10 years, $15,000 for subcontracting. We had budgeted $60,000 for hard pack, but we were really spending less than $50,000 a year. And I bring this up only simply to show that and I've been with a couple different towns, and I've also acted as a finance administrator, and I don't think I've seen a budget as lean as the one that we had been running on previously. And that's good from the tax rate and the person paying taxes. It's good to keep the tax rate low. It's good to keep the budgets low. It is, again, good for the paying public, but only from really the pocketbook point of view. What is really not happening, or what was happening in this instance, is along with kind of running lean and individual expense line items being kind of under budgeted, Bob is town manager, and Bob did a great job, but Bob was wearing many hats. He was health officer. He was essentially the de facto department head for the highway department. He was going over there every day. Bill was on staff. He's the foreman, but he was more like a shift supervisor than a department head. Bob kind of had oversight of the highway department in the day-to-day operations. We had, again, gotten rid of the buildings and grounds person, so Bob was doing the ordering for the, you know, toilet paper and tissues. You know, there was just a fair amount that fell within the responsibility of the town manager itself. Now, I'm not saying it's necessarily a bad thing that the town manager be able to do, you know, some of this stuff. And, you know, everybody needs to do different things, particularly in municipal governance. You know, you need to be able to, you know, recognize when things need to be done and you know, step up and do things that, you know, clean floors or you know, dust. And I think we've all done that here. However, you pay Bob, or you paid Bob, and you pay me, you know, over $40 an hour, and to be doing essentially overweight permits, or to be doing driveway permits, or to be ordering tissue and things like that, it saves on the bottom line. But what you're paying us for, the big ticket things like the Three Corners intersection, budgeting discussions such as this, you know, putting maintenance plans together, is kind of what you pay us for. And at the end of the day, when you wear that many hats, it's difficult to get the important things done. And we've talked about this quite a bit, that, you know, just to, for instance, some of the things that I've been working on, such as the Three Corners intersection, the rec center steps, the Mace Hill culvert, basically everything that's been on my plate and everything that's been getting done, and I've been, you know, here for 3.5 years now, predates me by 5 to 7 years, if not more. So it's, you need to have that balance between the spending and being able to put the pieces in place so the important things get done, and the important things that get done in an efficient manner, and not just for the town manager, but for the municipality itself, for the entity to effectively run. So, for instance, you know, being able to collect the taxes, being able to write the checks, being able to perform the rec center programs effectively, being able to, you know, implement and plan on the paving and the roadside ditching, etc. All needs to be done efficiently, and if you don't have enough pieces in place, it's difficult to do that. So what did we do going forward in the fiscal year 19? We started to increase our spending, but to coincide with that, and I'm sure the staff all remembers it, but we did cut the staff health insurance from the platinum plan to the gold plan. In that time, we also had a deficit in the general fund. I believe it was about $180,000. We started to address that. Part of that effort was to take a loan for the 21 Route 12 house. And then we started to put the spending in place and budget for the maintenance that we have on a year-to-year basis for our buildings. And we upped the capital improvements essentially by 30 grand. That comes down a bit in the fiscal year 22 budget. But we were able to put things together such as the roof for the library and other important items that we had to do. And that started to kind of move things forward, particularly on the buildings maintenance and capital improvements. Fiscal year 20, here for the next 2 years, we focused considerably on the highway department. But to go back to the fiscal year 18 budget, where prior to that, we had dropped the buildings and grounds position. And again, you know, talking about being able to effectively get things done, you know, who the folks that picked up the slack for the buildings and grounds position was the highway department. So you had highway people coming in to, you know, if Val had an issue at the activity center or if there's an issue with Damon Hall, more importantly, the shoveling and the plowing of the buildings. The highway department was doing that, which of course takes them away from the roads themselves. So we identified that and we got a, put it in the budget to hire back a buildings and grounds person. And we also started to increase the spending. Again, I talked about up here in fiscal year 18, how we had been at $80,000 paving, subcontracting, hard pack had been fairly stagnant. We started to increase that in fiscal year 20, a little bit in 19, but more so a more concerted effort in fiscal year 20. And that kind of set the scales or set the direction anyways for fiscal year 21, where we again continue to focus on the highway department. Again, this is kind of a concerted effort to bring the spending in line with our needs. We've identified a decent amount of deferred maintenance in the roads, particularly the paving and the ditching and the materials that we put down on the roadway. So we also, in fiscal year 21, to kind of build on the buildings and grounds department, we hired a new highway person, and we just put that into place not even a month ago. A couple of weeks ago, we hired on a Hartland person, Chuck Thorburn. And the rationale for that was to take that extra highway person being the foreman and allow him to do the managerial duties that he needs to do. So he's not necessarily digging a ditch, but he's lining up the jobs such as pipe for the paving. He's lining up you know, whoever we have subcontracted to do the ditching or the culvert replacement or whatever needs to be done the next day needs to coordinate with the garage because the dump truck needs to go to the garage. You know, somebody's out sick, so he needs to shuffle things around. Pulls him out of the ditch and puts him into more of a managerial position. And why is that important? Because now the town manager doesn't need to spend the time focusing on where the four to five individual highway employees are. You can focus more on managing and directing the municipality as a whole. So we kind of built on some blocks there, putting pieces into place to kind of give some infrastructure, give some structure, but more importantly, to kind of delegate important tasks to people that can focus on them and to see that they get them through. So a good part of the effort here is making sure that we delegate so that things that the municipality or the residents are expecting to get done can get done. One of the major things, and it was one of the funkiest things I've ever seen, people, again, to go back to that fiscal year 18 budget and before, people are ecstatic that they're paying, you know, less in taxes. However, they're still paying taxes. So I don't know how many phone calls I got saying, look, I pay all this in taxes, but I can't drive on my road. I'm paying all this in taxes, but my road's falling apart. there was no real, you know, well, hey, you're paying less in taxes than you should be, so you may have a pothole or two. The expectation was there that the road shouldn't have potholes. Well, we can't do that unless we put the pieces into place. So we've been doing that. So that's kind of the past. Now, where are we going forward? We're continuing to build on those blocks, okay? We're continuing to put pieces into place so we can get things that's expected of us to get them done, or things that people may not even know the municipality does or needs. However, internally, we see it, and we know that it's gummed up, it's not working. Those pieces need to be put into place as well. So for the fiscal year 22 budget, it's kind of more of the same. Continued focus on the highway department. However, I should note that last year and coming into this year, the select board did set up a roads committee. Phil and Gordon participated on that. And this has been to the select board. They set certain benchmarks, key kind of assets that are important to road maintenance, road surface, ditching, asphalt, paving, culverts, we're all kind of a part of that. So we continue on that path of trying to reach those goals. And when we set those goals, there was recognition that there would be a 3 to 4 year process to put those into place. Knowing that, kind of like the last three budgets that I just went through, you can't just go from A to Z. You kind of got to go through each of the letters of the alphabet. And so we're trying to take that and get to a point, get to those levels, but over some doable years. In addition to that, it's difficult for us to just, you know, it's difficult for us to just go from $50,000 to $100,000 a hard pack, because we haven't been spreading $100,000 a hard pack. So we need to learn from each year and as we increase and where we're putting it and how we put it so that we can put that down effectively. And again, we've been doing that, but the point here is that was to be over 3 to 4 year process, and we build on that. The biggest component of the fiscal year 22 budget is ordinance enforcement and planning. And we've been talking about this top piece here for 2 years now, building permit. Actually, that should just be ordinance, not an and. A building permit, ordinance, or just a straight building ordinance. And that is needed for several reasons, and we've talked about this, but identifying new building in town so that it gets captured on the grand list is an important part of that piece. Knowing where the building is happening, you know, making sure that it gets the 911 address to go along with that. So we kind of want a systematic process in place, and we think that the building permit and ordinance can be a juncture for that. You know, I was talking to Clyde today. I was kind of surprised to hear, you know, the number of 911. It's only, I mean, it's not huge, you know, 911 addresses in the past year, maybe 12. Interestingly enough, I've only had one driveway permit in that same period of time. So obviously they kind of know enough to go to Clyde to get the 911 address, but they don't really want to deal with the driveway permits. So this grouping of responsibilities right here are fairly similar. So in passing the building permit ordinance, and it was discussed at the time when we accepted the building permit ordinance, that it would need an administrator. But there's other things out there in town that aren't getting done that fall on the town manager at this point. And that's one of the reasons they don't get done. I've got other things on my plate that I group with this administrator. So the building permit ordinance is a piece of that. It's a very important piece that we want to implement and put into place. And that'll take time to kind of put into place, but there's other things out there. The enforcement of the ordinances that we already have, a junkyard ordinance, for instance, and it doesn't take much to kind of rattle off a few, but you know, Route 5 has a few just outside of town. Also, towards Hartford, the Hall residence, Shoot Road, North Hartland on Mill Street, North Hartland on Route 5, Martinsville Road, Queechee Road at the corner of Independence Drive, Route 12 at the Four Corners, Route 12 heading to Cowdery's. Those don't even include Dave Cowdery's or Tobin's. There is a lot out there that should be picked up, and that would fall under this particular position that is being proposed in the fiscal year 22 budget. Floodplain bylaws is also important. We don't do a whole lot with it, but there is floodplain issues readily in plain sight. The floodplain bylaws are also necessary for us to get our ERAF, our proportionate share of FEMA reimbursement. 911 addresses currently is done by the town clerk's office. I don't think that is the appropriate place for 911 addresses or the appropriate position to be administering 911 addresses. Again, it gets clumped in with these other things that would correspond with a building permit or would correspond with a driveway permit, and take that off of the town clerk. Also mapping, which we do little of outside of the lister's office. I think that Bill and myself and could work with this position as far as inventorying what we have done for highway maintenance, where we need to go, issues that we're having on the roads. There's a fair amount we can do. We talked last meeting about emergency management and identifying assets that might be vulnerable to storms on mapping. We're somewhat separate from the fire department. We can map our fire assets, such as you know, where we draw water from. And the other thing of possible responsibility is the health officer, which right now is essentially a volunteer position. Could be a stipend, but again, it gets close to a volunteer position. Getting very difficult to find people to do that, and the state is asking more and more of that position. So this position gets buried in a hurry. There's plenty for this position to do and things that we need to be doing in town. One, because the residents expect us to be doing certain things. And the town needs these things to run efficiently. We also need to be doing that. And a lot of these things fall through the cracks. So that brings us to the actual budget itself. Again, I went over the highlights of the main movers of the budget. I'm going to show overall the budget, but I'm going to kind of, again, stick to the highlights of the some of the, again, we'll hit on the ordinance administration, we'll hit on highway, but there's a couple other things that are driving the budget. And I've got them highlighted here. So I'll start with the general fund. And this is on the general fund expenses. Total administration, you can see a big jump here. Essentially, that is two things. It is health insurance. Health insurance for really two things, three things maybe. Here you see it here is about a $50,000 difference. One, that is health insurance for the newly proposed position for ordinance enforcement, ordinance administration. But as you all may recall, Doug Linnell is retiring in December. and Stacy, who is going to be stepping into the full-time position. Doug did not get health insurance. His wife had health insurance. He didn't need it. However, Stacy will be getting health insurance. So that's about a close to a $20,000, $15,000 jump for her. And also in the recreation department with the changing there, there's a not quite as large increase, but a smaller increase between Jack and Jenna. So that's a pretty big increase, but it's due to health insurance. Also a fairly big percentage increase. It's not dramatic as $50,000, but our workers' compensation increased. It actually affects the highway department more than the general fund. However, it is worth noting, and that's what drives the administrative increase there. Total assessment. This should not come as any surprise, although there is some good news here. Under the assessment, we pick up the, and it's not the highlighted one, we pick up the Three Corners intersection bond. The first payment is a little under $25,000. It will balloon after that, and I'll get into our debt a little bit later on, but next year it'll be close to 70. However, it is there. It is a $25,000 increase for us. And also right here under fire truck, fire department capital reserve, it goes from 49 to 61. Increase, and that's kind of to make up for back when we were increasing some other things. We cut the fire department reserve for a couple of years. We're kind of overcompensating for it now to catch back up. Again, I'll go into this a little bit like the debt. I'll go into this in a short while. But that is also a mover for us. And the Three Corners Capital Project Fund, I'll talk a little bit about this at a later select board meeting, but we should be budgeting now that we're going to a bond, and technically the town still needs to pay back the capital project fund of $100,000. We have going from last year to this year, we have an increase of over $100,000 in our fund balance. And speaking with the auditors, I would recommend that we take that and we pay off the the capital project fund and make that whole. And therefore, it takes away that $20,000 to $25,000 hit, and it cleans that up very nicely at a very good time as the bond will be kicking in. So with that fund balance, and again, we'll get a little bit into it as we get into the some of the audit numbers. But there is a fund balance available, and we do have the ability to pay that off, and that is my recommendation, and it alleviates that, which would be, I think, a very nice step for us to make that whole at this point. I already spoke about the ordinance administration and planning.
Hey, Dave.
Yes.
Just a clarification question on that. So if I'm looking at this, the budget, the comparative budget general fund expenses, and I'm on page 2 of 13, the second from the last in total assessment, you're proposing that Three Corners Capital Project Fund line item go from $0 to $100,000 next year.
No.
Okay, then I misunderstood, sorry.
So you have positive fund balance, essentially a cumulative surplus in the general fund.
Okay.
That will not affect, so you can essentially take that $100,000 and transfer it from the general fund to the capital project fund, okay, and pay off that loan completely.
Okay. So that's the excess from this last fiscal year.
Yes.
Okay. Thanks.
You're welcome. I should note in the copies that I did make some changes today from the copies that I brought to you yesterday. One of which, in the copies I brought to you yesterday, this was a $14,000 number. I double checked it. It should be a $24,000 number. And what I did was I decreased a capital improvement number from 9,250 to 4,250. And I'll probably hit on that next, I think. I can go to that. This is total capital improvements here. It's actually a negative number. It goes from 60 to 35,000. This is very important. I really kind of want to hone in on this. It was important that we increased it. I've decreased it, one, because of the overall budget numbers, but also two, simply to focus on those items that need to be done. So it was 60,000, it comes down to 35,000, but the two items here are the activity center floors. The activity center being the Four Corners Children's Center. Those floors need to be done, particularly as a daycare center. And the $10,750 is for the stairs for Damon Hall, the last remaining stair that did not get done. This is the estimate that's coming in for that. John and I talked about to great lengths, including the walking path at the Foster Meadow Fields, which had a estimated price of $22,000. I took that out partially because of the price in the budget, but more importantly, just being able to focus and to get the projects done that we're proposing to get done. I just felt it was a little bit too much activity, even with John kind of carrying the ball on that. We're looking at hopefully doing the Three Corners intersection project next summer. Again, I'll throw it out there, a lot could hang that up, that it doesn't get done next summer, but right now we are still very much looking at that date. A lot is going to be happening in the spring to line up that project. And that would have coincided with the walking path. And I think that that's just too much to try and really focus on and do effectively. And at the end of the day, from a priority point of view, the floors at the activity center is kind of a safety issue. And I'd like to finish up the Damon Hall steps. So we dropped, basically I dropped after not a whole lot of sleep on Saturday night, early in the morning on Sunday morning is when I kind of made that decision and I pulled it out for those reasons. And I think that they're good reasons. In the budget that I brought to you yesterday, this was a $9,250 number. I adjusted this when I adjusted the Three Corners bond upwards. I adjusted this downwards. This number is for two reasons, really. It's one, in case something else happens other than these two things that need to be addressed. I've got some money there just in case. It's also possible that this one could potentially come in over, of which case we need this. And at the very least, we put $4,000 to a reserve account for the library HVAC 2 years ago, basically under the same premise. If we don't use it, that's where it should go. We put that there for that particular reason, because we know it's got a short lifespan. And we've got the ability to, Selectboard has the ability to pull that out in case we need it. The rec program, you see a downward trend there. There's really only one reason for that, and that's due to the coronavirus. We have skewed some things down a little bit. Although the after-school program, the payroll, we've brought down a little bit more in line with what we're doing historically, although I spent a fair amount of time with John trying to hone in on what that number should be. And the summer camp payroll as well, although some of these other numbers, you know, things like the teen adventures, I cut like half, and I cut the programs, the payroll and the amount that we put towards the programs by half. However, on the revenue side, I also have that. I am anticipating, you know, it's kind of a wild guess, you know, but the expenses and revenues are kind of proportional. If we get the demand, the revenue goes up and the expenses go up. If we don't get the demand, the revenues go down and the expenses go down. So it's kind of a sliding scale, so to speak. However, I am expecting teen adventures to kind of roll next summer. It may not roll earlier on, but as the summer goes along, I think that it may pick up and we may end up doing some summer programs simply because what I'm hearing is that the vaccine will be out in the spring. And by May-ish, possibly June-ish, perhaps activity returns to a more normal state. In which case I would expect maybe a slow start, and then maybe as the summer goes along, things kind of pick up. So that's kind of the rationale there. That's really the only reason for the decrease in the expenses there. In the miscellaneous, this drop is basically, we had $25,000 for cleanup to the 21 Forkbrook Road property that I don't have in there for this particular fiscal year 22. If the sale falls through, then we'll need to put that back in. And again, I would rather put that back in than the walking path over at Foster Meadows Fields, because this is going to then become much more of a priority. But at the moment, we're looking at a sale on that, and I take that out, and that's what the decrease is there. The only problem, so it gives us about a 4.86% increase in expenses. On the revenue side, we run into a small hiccup here. You can't see it because we've got an estimated tax amount. But then when we get into the tax rates, you'll see that this number here actually is a larger increase than what the expense increase is. And that's because you see a decrease in revenues, not only in the rec center, but in the general fund as well. And the rec center, again, is just anticipated. I mean, it's not a huge difference. You know, we're talking, you know, 12 grand, but enough. And again, this is just, you know, expected slow start to the year, and therefore numbers are down a bit. However, up here, we see things that the interest is a direct result of the pandemic. The interest rate that we're getting from the bank is lower than it was the last several years. I'd like to think that picks up, but I'm going to budget conservatively. So we've essentially almost halved that, what we were expecting. And as we continue to go to tax sale on delinquent houses, we see that the delinquent interest on that has been decreasing over the last several years. Judicial fines is also down quite a bit. That's basically because my understanding is because the state police and even James, but particularly the state police, is hesitant to pull people over due to the virus, particularly early on. I believe that that's pretty well continuing. So we've got a budgeted decrease there, lower expectation. And also, I'm expecting a less coming back from the hold harmless payment, which is essentially the properties that are in conservation. The state makes up the property tax for those people that haven't in conservation. That's a lower number, although it does come back to us in just the regular property taxes. And the pilot payment, I've got an increase here. I'm going against my better judgment. I like the contract, and this should have been $15,000 here. That's a typo. But the contract states that at a bare minimum, we get $15,000 from the North Hartland Dam. And then it's based on essentially flow after that. However, I know $15,000 is the number we're going to get. Everything else is kind of an unknown. So I generally go conservative and go with the $15,000. However, traditionally, it looks like we're getting more. So I kind of offset this decrease with what it looks like we've been getting in from the North Hartland Dam. I won't get too much into the details, but just a caveat to this is they're going to be, that agreement is going to be ending in this fiscal year. However, the municipal amount, not the school, but the municipal amount of the assessed value is about $28,000. So that number is not too far off. So I'm feeling pretty safe about it. But just know that there is a decrease in the general fund that affects the tax rate. Highway, there's increases kind of throughout. However, they are kind of strategic increases. The highway administration increase here that you see of the 8.52%, that is again workers' compensation. And you can see it. Whoops. Right here, goes from 18,000 to 27. Pretty significant difference. For us, and again, the workers' comp, I can't remember the incident, but there was somebody that was injured and utilized workers' compensation. You know, the insurance picked it up and is now hitting, it's now a part of the numbers that they use to charge us our premium. And that's why you're seeing the increase that significantly in both the general fund and the highway department. Paving and resurfacing, this is a big jump here. It's probably the biggest jump in the highway department, $30,000. This, again, going back to my initial slide, we started at $80,000. The goal with the roads committee is to get to $200,000. We make the jump from 140 to 170. That's probably the biggest driver here. And again, that's to get us to where we need to go. And my only comment there is if you drive our paved roads, you can see pretty quickly, particularly my hurry to get that to 200,000, because we do have almost all 10 miles of our roads are in need of being addressed. And we've done maybe a mile and a half the past 3 years. So we need to get to a place that we're getting to at least a mile a year and get into a good cycle. And again, the theory here is that once we get into a cycle and we get to some good maintenance, that these numbers can start to become more a little flatter. Much more flatter and more predictable than where we've been. I'm just going to go over two more things in the highway department. Under summer maintenance, some of the things that we honed in here, and again, this was a part of the roads committee. The subcontracting, which is again, big line for our ditching, goes from 25,000 to 35. The subcommittee recommendation was 55. So we got a couple more years to go there. We also make some movement on stone. We probably could have made a bigger one, but I'll live with 6 to 10 for now. You can see some of the history here. And guardrails, we go from 3,500 to 7,500. We spent 9,000 this year. If we do Barron Hill, just one of those segments, even if Green Mountain Power pays half, we're going to be on the hook for $5,000. So that goes pretty quick. And there's plenty of places that we need to do guardrail replacement. So that wasn't a part of the roads committee, but certainly a necessary one. Lastly, the other increase is in the amount that we put into our equipment fund. And that jumps from 300,000 to 312. We did purchase a bucket loader, and we put that, we used a lease with that. So that takes away some of our ability to, you can see where we put 177, close to 178,000 actually into the reserve, or what we're trying to do for budget 21. Proposed or estimated for this year is 154,693. We need to keep that number in that range in order for us to continue to get to where we need to go. And that's why the increase from 300 to 312. So what does that all mean? So combined, so for the highway, it's a 7.10% increase for that particular fund. With the general fund, it's a 4.86% increase. So combined, the overall budget increase is 5.78%, which actually isn't too bad for us. We've been hovering the last 2 years about 9.5. So we've been able to get to a little bit of a better place while implementing, I think, some important pieces. However, the revenue side of the equation hurts us a bit. So even though the expense increase is only 4.86%, the general fund tax rate, the amount needed to raise the taxes needed to offset expenses, is an 8.39% increase. Again, that's because we saw revenues go down while some of the expenses went up. Highway fund tax rate is 7.81%. Combined makes for, and this is for basically the general fund, highway fund, and the local tax rate included, which is essentially the veterans exemption, gives us a 7.84% increase in the tax rate. If you have a $250,000 house, that's an increase of $108.50 is what you would, and that we use the 250 because that's used to be, I think we're probably getting more towards the 300,000 at this point, but it's kind of been the benchmark we use as kind of the average household assessed value. And again, $108.50 increase. So that's the gist of the budget. I kind of wanted to get through that. A couple other things I want to get into before I open it up to questions. There is a cost of living increase for the employees. I do this so that the wages stay in check with inflation. It is based off of an indicator. I basically use the Northeast CPI index, and that was year to October or November. It was a 1.2% increase. It's been down the last couple of years. I think 3 years ago it was 2.6% or something to that effect. So the cost of living increase is included. Otherwise, if we don't include that, then the wages are essentially downward. And then from there, I only altered two people this year, actually more than two, but I'll get into that in a second. In the past couple of years, John Leonard, we altered last year. I brought Bill up, I think 2 years ago or the year before that, we did Clyde. We've done the highway workers over the past couple of years. So essentially, I feel pretty good where we're at pay-wise in relation to the VLCT booklet that they put out on wages for municipalities. We are at an average wage. I brought Martin up a little bit to just put him in check. I gave him essentially 3% to get him to what the average rate is. And for the first time in a couple of years, I gave myself one. 3% gets me to essentially goes from like 85 to 87. However, out of the group, there is one employee that does not hit the average, and that is the town manager's salary, which is a good number below the average, but we will address that in a different year. But that's why I brought that up to the 87, which is about a 3% increase. Just a couple other things I want to hit on. As far as why I upped the amount going into the equipment fund. So here is kind of where we've been 2018. I've gone out to 2027. This is the budgeted year that we're looking at. We have proposed a six-wheeler International that's our older dump truck at this point in time. And I've got a number in here, doesn't affect things too much, but a potential second grader. I haven't talked about that in a while. I've talked about it in the past. And what that would do, it would be a used grader used in the springtime. And then we would kind of get into a rotation. The grader that we got should be good for, I don't know, another 12, 15 years. But 12, 15 years from now, the grader that we've got would then kind of go to the second grader when we need to purchase a new one. And that one would then become the spring grader. But that, again, is kind of a small piece of the puzzle. For fiscal year 22, the six-wheeler is what we've got on tap. And then we kind of go back into our cycle. We're looking at rotating our trucks through every 6 years. We're on warranty for 6 years. When it comes off warranty, looking at trading it in. Keeps the value of the trade-in high, makes the the resale or when we need to go purchase a new truck lower, and theoretically it should keep our maintenance down. So we do see a six-year cycle here, and some of the numbers that I'm using may very well, these numbers may be high because I'm using the actual purchase prices of the vehicles that we just purchased. And again, if they're in decent shape, this number hopefully is lower. But again, budgeting conservatively, this is what the numbers I've used. But this here, going from 2024 to 2025, we get pretty thin. And I do expect, except for maybe this second grader, which is, you know, discussion to be had, but I think it would be tremendously beneficial for us, which brings that number up to maybe 99, which still makes me feel pretty darn uncomfortable. In order to get that, here's the number I'm proposing, the 154,693 going into this particular budget year. That's if this holds. This is a true number here. This is a proposed number. This is a proposed number. And notice I'm using a $160,000 number, which is greater than this for future years. I think it's important that we go and give it that $12,000 increase and try and keep this number, which is the important one here, at a comfortable level. The good news here is that we've been successful over the past 3 to 4 years. We have been able to rotate our equipment through. You've heard this before, but I kind of like to tell it. There's nothing worse than coming back from a day of skiing at Suicide Six with your daughter and seeing two of our dump trucks on the side of the road broken down during a snowstorm, which is a true story. And at this point, I think that all except for this six-wheeler here, I think that we are getting to a better place. Truck number 14, the four-wheel drive, six-wheel truck is somewhat problematic for us as well, but we've gained quite a bit, so that's a good story, but this is what we just need to kind of keep an eye on as we go forward. You may ask about the fire trucks and the increase to the fire equipment fund. This one's a little bit more simplistic. Again, we had this dip here a couple of years ago. We have been cruising along at $50,000. It dipped down 25 this one particular year, and we've kind of come slowly back up to get to an affordable place. The forestry truck is our next purchase. Speaking with John Sanders, this was originally scheduled for right here. He seems to think that we can put it off till 2023. He doesn't think we should put it off any farther than that. Leaves us in okay position because we need to rebound out here in 2028 for engine number two. Bill might be able to tell you better. I think that's a pumper truck. I think it's out at North Hartland. We need to replace that. Leaves us in decent position, but what's not on here are two purchases we need to do in the 2030s. And it leaves us pretty thin for those. So we need to, this number is definitely one that we should shoot for. Not to get us to here, I think we get there okay, but we need to get the two trucks beyond that, which is just looking out, maybe beyond our time, but I think they'll probably appreciate it when the time comes that we've got money available for them. Our debt, this number there, that's what we are going to expect next year for the Three Corners intersection. It is going to hamper us. This is the next fiscal year, next budget year. That's going to be our high. Right now, we've got about $110,000in general fund debt. We've got the two fire trucks here that we're paying off. We start to slowly lose those. However, with the 72, we're at a high for the fiscal year 23, but then it starts to come down, and it will come down, provided we don't get into anything else. But there are other things that we're going to need to discuss in future years. But for tonight, this is what it looks like. And with the general fund, we had paid off the Western Star, which is the four-wheel drive, six-wheel truck. However, because the equipment fund was starting to show signs of being low, it would have been, I think the number was 150 hit. We took out a lease, so we picked that up. So overall, we're paying $141,000 in debt this year. Next year, it's $161,000, and then it starts to decrease after that. And the last item I'm going to get into is just simply, this kind of comes up each year, the rec center. As a policy, we like the programs to at least pay for the programs, and the town picks up essentially John and a good part of Jenna. This year, looking at this, so this is the revenues and expenses, leaves a hole or a differential of about $138,000. If you look down here, John and Jenna combined is about $150,000. So yes, we cover it. However, if you factor in the physical plant, if you factor in the upkeep of the rec building, we fall short a little bit. So I think that this is an important marker here. I think we need to kind of keep an eye on that and kind of tighten that a little bit going forward. However, when you look at, these are proposed numbers, when you look at actual numbers, the actual numbers tend to cover that amount. It's when we're looking at proposed budgets that we fall a little bit short. So just kind of a tidbit to keep track of. That's pretty well proposed budget for fiscal year 22. At this point, I will open it up for anybody that may have some questions.
Hey, Dave, it's Mary. I had a hard time seeing those numbers. I was wondering if you could increase the font or the view or whatever. Full page or
on my screen or on yours?
Yeah, on your screen.
I can, but the problem, Mary, is I can if you, from an overall perspective, I can't. I mean, I can, but you lose, you know, I can hone in on parts of the budget. So if you want to look at something, if you want to look at something specific, Mary, then I can, you know, I can zoom in. But if you want, you know, kind of see the, you know, again, I was kind of giving a macro discussion, you know, and parts of this, you know, is just to kind of give you an overall perspective of the nuts and bolts of the budget.
I know. But even following, trying to follow the debt schedule, it was difficult to see.
So, Mary, you tell me where you want more visuality, and I can hone in on it, or I can try.
Well, I guess wherever the next questions are.
Okay. You know, so. Yeah, I can hone in on that. But then you're going to kind of lose the, you know, so if I push, if I push it forward to just the pertinent 5 years, you know, then I can go probably higher, I think.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I know what you're saying. So you can, we could see the part better, but we lose the whole.
Yeah, Dave, in the lower right hand corner of your screen, there's a slider. You can, right there, you can dial it in.
And if it's only my problem, then forget it. Maybe nobody else is having this problem.
We can test out Mary's theory. Dave, I have two questions. One, could you review the significant increase in the health insurance? You know, I think I heard there was a factor of both the provider having an increase as well as the number of people having coverage. I just want to make sure I understand that.
So we, we budget about a 10% increase. I think MVP had a 6% increase this year. You know, I've seen 12, I've seen 3. We go conservative with about a 10. However, here, there's more to it than that. So, for instance, and we budget to the highest extent, so with the new position, we just assume, you know, for budgeting purposes, that's going to be a family. So a family runs, you know, insurance runs about $24,000. You know, a two-person or a mother and kids runs about $15,000. An individual about $7,000. So we had three people that had increases. You know, we picked up, or I've budgeted a new position with health insurance. We've picked up a new person that, a position, existing position that didn't have health insurance before and now does. And we have a person that, can't remember what Jenna is at, but it's more than what Jack was. So combined, the three of those goes from, you know, it was about a close to a $50,000 jump.
Okay, thank you. My second question, again, without diving into too much detail, you referenced the road committee and some of the proposed increases, which we hope to see, and we as a board have set the path for over the next 3 years. One of the items that I look for, but I didn't see, is to start a reserve fund for culverts, specifically stream crossing culverts, and that was done in recognition of the number of issues that we've had over the past years and the continued impact of global warming and weather on the roads. Are we starting that this year?
So I don't have that budgeted, Phil. I've stuck with, I think, the three most key components to the road being, the asphalt, the paving, which I think we're drastically behind in, as well as the ditching. And, you know, some of that budgeting for the ditching, it's important that we, one, not only keep up with the hydro-connected ditching, but Bill and I are recognizing the need. There's some real key places that aren't hydro-connected that need ditching. Mm-hmm. So that's the second component. And then again, keeping up with the equipment, I think is a bigger need than the culvert reserve. Mm-hmm. So that's kind of the foremost thinking. On top of that, Phil, and I looked into this when we had Martinsville Road and Clay Hill Road go on us, just because I was thinking that, you know, Martinsville Road, you know, I was almost thinking $150,000 plus project. And that's what one of the original estimates came in at. So two things, we have a highway reserve fund that we haven't used, you know, maybe since 2000, I can't remember if it was 2007 or 2011 that was put in place that we haven't broached. We have a $300,000 surplus in the highway department that I think we will, even with the issues that we've had, I think that we will maintain most of that. And then a third thing is that the Three Corners Intersection project is no longer attached at the hip to the capital project fund. So you also have access to the capital project fund for capital projects such as that. So we've got, I think ultimately we need to start budgeting for that, Phil, but the immediate need I didn't see being with that particular line item. Again, you know, we're trying to shoot between 3 and 5 years here to get to where we need to go with the roads. And I think that we've got some pieces in place to fall back on if we need to. Whereas with the other ones, the other line items, we don't.
Okay. Thank you.
Dave, I was wondering if any of the staff, department heads have any comments or thoughts on the budget?
I don't know.
I really do not. This is Bill. Doug, Dave and I have talked quite a bit about the budget, so I don't really have many questions or much to say about it unless anyone has any questions for me.
I'll concur with Bill. Dave and I have been working on this for the last 3-4 months and trying to get it going, and I concur with Bill.
And this is Doug. I've also, Dave and I have spoken about our budget and stuff, and we're here to ask any, answer any questions, but I think we've tried to plan, tried to anticipate what needs to happen next year and reflects that.
Hi, this is Nancy, and Dave and I have spoken, and the library board and I have developed our budget, and I know we'll be presenting it to the select board next Monday on the 30th. But if there are any general questions tonight, I'm here in the background.
I was just wondering on the clerk side, how the total budget, you know, especially the incoming clerk's salary was going to stay the same as I proposed, or what?
Clyde, I haven't changed anything with you. In that salary remains as budgeted presently. So I have got that everything that's in place and as you proposed to me is all there. So let me just it did get the 1.2% increase, Clyde, as well with the salary. I don't know if you have any.
No, I was just thinking that when Brian takes over, he'll be doing all the necessary work of the clerk's office. All the extra stuff you get out of my brain won't be available, but that was a fringe benefit of my brain. So the work goes on, whether or not the odds and ends of who was where and when they were there might disappear, but I'm glad to see that it's going to hold in there. So,
hey, Dave, this is Curtis.
Yep.
So just this is my unfamiliarity with the process. These appropriations that you have here, are these like you sent out requests to all of the organizations to update their appropriations requests and this is what they responded, or how does that work?
So we have heard back. I was talking to Michelle today. Right now I've got budgeted in and I have not heard of anybody request an increase to their amounts. And I think that may have a lot to do with the fact that if you increase the amount, you need to get a, you need to petition, you need to re-petition. And I'm not sure anybody wants to petition in this atmosphere that we're living in.
So that's actually really interesting. I was just having a conversation. I think that petition rule may have been suspended for this year.
So even if it's been suspended, Curtis, I'm just hypothesizing.
Yeah.
Okay. Nobody except for the fire department, which is simply got a small bump of $1,400 for essentially inflation. Without saying whether you need to petition or not, everybody has put this in as the similar request as the year before.
Okay. And then I just, as the nature of this meeting is really high level, as you said. I was wondering if you could maybe talk a little bit about what, if we saw extreme circumstances from Corona over this winter, what, how that might impact the budget or what you foresee happening there.
So if anything, it's going to impact this year's budget. So I am going based upon my nightly feed of the three cable networks that I kind of tune into. For next year's budget, unless the wheels fall off here somewhere, Dr. Fauci's telling me that by Easter, we may be in a little bit better place. And then going from May to June, seeing a more increased place for activity. So I'm going to kind of hang my hat. Everybody tells me that I should pay attention to Fauci. So that's kind of where we're at. But if it goes south, it's going to be a this year issue. And it would need to deteriorate to quite a place, but you know, we have from now until mid-January to, you know, drastically change numbers. But
I wonder specifically, one of the big impacts we had last year was, or slash this fiscal year, was the revenue from the rec center. And I'm wondering what would you see happening, or what options would we have if we had similar revenue this upcoming summer as we had last summer from the rec center?
So we're not in as bad a place as we were when this kind of, where we came into this, because from a budget perspective, I mean, so we'll be in the hole maybe 20, you know, 15 grand again. But then again, if we don't overspend, the state's given us 15 to 20 grand as a grant. So where it happens, the way this is kind of, our budget is set up, is the rec center essentially, you know, most of the activity with the summer camp and the team, I want to call them Teen Titans, but anyway, the team program in the summertime, those expenses happen. However, the people sign up for it before July 1st. So the revenue actually comes in the prior fiscal year, or in this case, the year that we're in, things really went south in the springtime, or their people are thinking of not participating, then we're going to see a shortfall in the revenue in the springtime, because they're not going to want to participate come summer. But this is in reverse from last year, in that as we go into the springtime, things are supposed to get better. So hopefully the revenue comes in, and then we swing into the summertime after July with what we've got budgeted. And actually, we budgeted less than we normally would. So in that respect, we should be pretty good. If at this point, for this year, you know, we only ran the summer camp with 20 kids. So we'd be out, you know, we would, you know, if things go bad now and we don't get that revenue for some reason, we'd be out revenue in the springtime. But the after-school program at this point in time is kind of, you know, pay as you go. So if they're no longer going, then they're no longer going to pay. And then we no longer are employing these people. So I think that that's pretty much going to be a wash. Does that make sense?
Yeah. So if I can restate it, and you can tell me if I'm wrong, it sounds like you're saying, even if we had as bad a summer this upcoming summer as we did this last summer, because of the nature of when our expenses occur relative to our revenue, we would only end up around 15 to 20,000 in the hole. And this last year, that was taken up by the state.
Yep.
Okay. Thank you.
Brian and I had a question that has nothing to do with budget figures. And the thing is, but is there any consideration of doing the total budget vote by Australian ballot if we can't have an open town meeting next year? And it affects the clerk's office in that making up the ballot and in a timely manner so it can be gotten, given out to the voters. So just something to put a bee in your bonnet to think about, because time is flying by.
Clyde, as we talked about in the staff meeting, that'll probably be on one of the upcoming select board meeting agendas outside of the budget presentation.
Yeah.
So that'll, they've gotten a couple heads up on that. And we'll tackle that coming up.
Okie doke.
Dave, I have an accounting question. Why does, this is on revenues, general fund revenues. Why does the Windsor County tax appear there?
Simply because we basically, when we set the tax rate, Gordon, we set, if you were to look at the town report, we set an actual county tax rate separately and raise it separately, so it shows up as a kind of a separate revenue line item.
Dave, this is Phil. I found myself last night a little confused and no comment there, please. But the we have the appropriations, and then we have separate articles for the fire department, for the rescue squad, for Aging and Heartland, and one or two others. Do we include those, or how do the, what's the impact of those articles to the budget that we're talking about tonight?
None. They're already in the budget.
Okay. So I didn't see, you know, support for the community nurse program as I looked through it last night.
It's in the Aging and Heartland 13,500 appropriation or whatever the number is.
Okay.
So it's, that item is just called community nurse. So.
Okay. Okay. Thank you. Thank you.
Dave, so I just want to say, Neil Allen put in the chat, I believe this was in response to not requiring a petition for the not-for-profits, that yes, that is possible. It was suspended, but only if we choose to not require it. So maybe the same time that we're thinking about Australian ballot for town meeting day, we could also do whatever we need to choose to not require that or not, whatever we want to do as a board. Does that make sense?
But again, it's only the fire department at this point. I think it would probably have been next meeting or the December 7th meeting.
For sure.
As to whether you would like to require the fire department, and you can do it for everybody, but you know, whether the fire department needs a petition or not, would be the question.
My only suggestion is that those seem related, so if we could consider them at the same meeting, that's the only request. Thank you.
Okay.
Clyde, this is Phil. You have a document management / digital digitizing record project. Is the source of money for that coming from a different place?
You mean where we're digitizing the records?
Yes, that's Yes.
We got a $17,700 grant from the state of Vermont to pay for that.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
And then I also got a $5,000 grant to buy equipment for elections. So, right. And we plan on upgrading. So, like, I would like to put in a drop box out front for using for ballots for elections, but it could be used as a drop box for tax payments or other stuff like that. Mm-hmm. But,
okay. Right. Thank you.
Yeah. The other thing about the suspension of petition signatures, the act that the legislature passed, that's only for officers, that they don't have to get signatures. They only have to sign a consent form. But for gimmies or social service programs, it would be up to the select board whether they didn't require a signature thing.
Dave, I had another question. So as we were going through the budget, you outlined to us something you would like to do that you think would be a good thing for the town to do, which is the repairs and maintenance to the walking path at Foster's Meadow, but you don't feel that we would have the capacity to do that in the same time. Are there other items like that you considered during the budget process that for reasons of finance or reasons of capacity you elected to leave off of this budget?
No, that is it. The only thing, and I've got written on my notes that I didn't get into, and I guess this may be a decent time. So, and it had to do, Mary, a little bit with the debt one. So internally, maybe some, additional part-time help for the town manager or something like that. You know, as far as immediate building blocks internally, putting into place the ordinance administrator and planner, which I might add is kind of a common position in most municipalities, except for they've got zoning to go along with it. It's kind of a leveling off in 2024. Next year we've got the bond increase, and then we've got kind of a leveling off. And I think, it would be easy for us to, sit back and say, okay, we're good for the next 30 years. I think that, these things have been driven by me and our administrative efficiencies that I think are important. I think that that is all part of setting ourselves up for the next 20, 25 years. However, I think at some point the select board needs to dig deep and ask the next set of questions. And again, these are long-term things. And we've got Queechee Road and we've got Jennyville Culvert, but that, again, that's kind of operations. At the end of the day, the highway department, that building is not going to stand another 25 years. I don't think that, let me put it another way, in 1980 something, they flagged the capacity of Damon Hall, and yet we're still here. I don't think administratively Damon Hall is going to suit us for 25 more years to come. Our salt shed, I don't think is going to suit us for 25 years to come. So at some point, there needs to be a discussion on some of these larger things that kind of loom out there. And again, I'm not pitching this just because, 2 years from now, I'm going to be bored. And it's like, okay, what's the next big thing? that's going to keep me busy. You know, I'm literally talking about what is going to, you know, set the town up to, you know, be able to fulfill its obligations as the town and the area continues to grow. And I think that, you know, it's certainly not addressable in this budget, and, you know, nor do I think it's addressable in the next couple of budgets. But I think it's a discussion that, you know, somebody should start having at some point in the next few years about, you know, our capabilities outside of what I've kind of put together here, that's going to allow us to continue to operate long after we're gone. A little bit more than I needed to say there, but I did have it on my notes here.
Okay. My computer's about to die. Should I grab my cord or? Yes. Sure. I'm going to go do that. I'll be back in a minute.
Anyone else have any questions for Dave?
Dave, this is Martha. Would you go back to those numbers you said, 5.78%, and then you said 7.84%, and I think you maybe even threw in some other percents. What are the important ones there, and can you clarify that for me?
So I think the big numbers, there's two big numbers here for you.
Dave, Martha, could you do that little Zoom trick there, please?
So Martha, I think this total budget being highway and general fund increase of 5.78% is important. I guess you can break that down between an increase in the highway fund of 7.10% and an increase in the general fund of 4.86. This is in expenses. However, translating that to tax rate, general fund tax rate, just the general fund, is 8.39% increase. Highway fund is 7.81%, making a estimated combined increase of 7.84%.
Okay, thank you.
Dave, I think it would be useful for you to send those, you could just email them, those charts to us. I mean, tomorrow, not now.
Okay.
Gordon, this is Mary. I have some questions, but I don't know that they fit into Dave's requirement that they only be macro level. So I don't know when I can safely ask these questions, when it's appropriate.
Mary, you can kind of ask any time, but just know, I mean, and we haven't finalized this, but I put in an email that we should have a meeting again on November 30th, in which case the library needs to present the library budget, and then I get a little bit more into details about individual departments, or can, and you know, that's when we can get into individual line items. But if you'd like to fire away tonight, you know, I'm okay with that.
All right, well, brace yourself, Dave. Where will the ordinance administrator be housed?
So right now, I'm looking at perhaps the rec center to do that. Kind of to go along with my spiel on Damon Hall, Yeah. There's really not too much space here, so it could potentially be at the rec center.
And is that a full-time position?
That would be a yes. There's really no way. And again, let me come back to what I'm pitching this person to do. So I'm pitching this person to not only do a building permit, but also ordinance enforcement, floodplain bylaw administration, 911 addresses, which speaking with Clyde is very hesitant to hand that over to Brian. And I don't think it fits with the clerk's office to begin with. Driveway permits and 911 addresses and driveway permits kind of go hand in hand. Overlay permits and mapping. So yes, it would be full time, but building permit would just be a part of what he does in building that whole system, but also strengthening and pulling together all these similar pieces into one spot.
Okay, so do you have any idea about the number of children at the school, the population there? Has there been any increase because of people from away buying and, you know, new kids moving in, or no?
So actually, no, it's going the other way. At least according to the town report. And the town report actually shows a decrease in students entering elementary. However, the number estimated in the next couple of years for the cooperative daycare is steady at about 20. However, the numbers overall at Hartland Elementary have been declining. And that's somewhat of a concern to me, actually. I'll just pop in real quick. So just kind of to hit on that, and I've spoken to John a little bit about this, but we've seemed to have stabilized a little bit this year at about 17 and a half kids in the after school program. But part of my fear going forward, and this is something we're gonna have to keep an eye on, John and I, is just that exact subject. So down here, and I ran out of time and I didn't do summer camp activities in the summertime, but the after school program actually declined quite a bit between 17 and 2020, all from about 25 down to 13. We come back up to about 17 and a half. However, you know, our payroll stays relatively static on that. Mm-hmm. Revenue and the students decrease. It's not too unlike what Vermont is seeing overall for a problem in its education, is that it's seeing declining enrollment, but the cost for per pupil really hasn't gone down to go along with that. My fear is that we see something a little bit similar here, which, you know, will threaten that revenue versus expenses and maintaining the programs if that kind of holds steady. So I'm not, Mary, at the moment, I'm not seeing that.
Okay. Another thought that occurred to me was the walking path. In terms of, because of COVID, more people are getting outside, and because you can't really do anything. How much is that walking path?
22,000.
Oh.
And, you know, I've given this some thought, and, you know, you can always pull that money out of the capital project fund if you felt it was, you know, necessary, but there's grass and people can walk on the grass and they can walk around that field just fine. Meanwhile, the floors at the activity center pose a problem, and I'm not entirely sure, you know, I think we're going to have a whole lot of activity going on if this Three Corners Intersection project goes forward. And I, again, you know, I'll be honest, it was a very, very difficult summer. We had a lot of projects going on, and, you know, you kind of lose track of some of them at some times, and it's just difficult to keep all those balls juggling. And I think that I had John put that estimate together. I've spoken to John. I've, you know, gotten on his case a little bit about it, because I felt, you know, I don't like the fact that it was put in and now it's, you know, gone away. But I can't, you know, it field can be used just fine the way it is for another year until we can, you know, get to a better place.
Well, aren't there like trip hazards or something? So somebody was complaining about some kind of, yeah, you can hurt yourself there. I know that somebody mentioned that.
Mary, John, I think you're talking about the FEMA planting, the trees that were planted to help stabilize the bank along Lulz Brook, which unfortunately, when those plantings went in, it took over some of the space of the walking path. So the walking path has to sort of veer around where that planting went in to stabilize Lulz Brook. But that was kind of out of our hands with that happened.
Right. Okay, you're right. That is what happened. I forgot that.
Yeah, if we, the plans that we have in place for the walking path would reroute it sort of to come further in away from Lulz Brook to get out of that space. Yeah. But that whole area has changed so much constantly. You know, it started back, was it, you know, with the big flood from, what year was that? 2011. But Lulz Brook keeps rerouting through there, unfortunately. And now we've got beavers doing all kinds of stuff back there and all these different dams that's just started to happen this fall as well.
So in line with Mary's comment and what you said, Dave, about it's so sad to see this thing that we have sort of go away. I'm wondering, we also, I imagine you can predict where this is going. I'm wondering what, if you think there's any space capacity-wise or in the budget to work to securing the facilities in North Hartland at Courier Park.
You know, Curtis, again, I got to go with the priorities here, and it's just going to pull us. You know, I could put a list of 12 things together I would love to do. You know, I've also talked to John about other things to do with the rec department, you know, but I've made a conscientious decision that, you know, there's just things that, you know, from a timing perspective, I'm not going to, you know, just isn't going to receive the concentration yet that it probably should get.
Yeah.
But, you know, again, I'm going to go back to, you know, my original slide and where we were at and, you know, where we're going.
Yeah.
And, you know, I kind of got to, you know, I won't do it now, but, you know, as I'm sitting at home tonight having a beer, I'm going to laugh here somewhere and say, you know, I'm amazed, you know, at the number of things that people seem to want to see happen. Yet 4 years ago, I didn't see any funding mechanism for any of this. You know, so again, to go back to my original discussion, there's a disconnect there, you know, and I'm sure we'll get into a discussion about, you know, the position that I'm proposing and, you know, the money and the budget and all this stuff. But, you know, I we could sit here and say the North Hartland School, I could sit here and listen to the Energy Committee and the buildings. I could sit here and listen to, you know, different groups and their needs, which are all kind of separate pieces that, you know, people want and are all great ideas and should occur at some point. The thing that's missing here, and this is the heart of my conversation, is that central cog, and having the resources in that central cog to help make these things happen. And until you get there, you know, you just gotta put a hold on some of this stuff until you're in a position to be able to do it. You know, I guess my argument would be, you know, you want to fix that up, but we got kids in a building over there in somewhat, I mean, it's safe, but we need to make it safer. You know, so I'm at a loss why we're going to put money and attention there when we have a revenue stream and a building being used, but it doesn't have what it needs. So
to clarify, Dave, I guess I'm not coming at you. I don't think you're doing a bad job.
But it's central. It's central to the conversation. It's central to what I'm trying to say here. And I don't think you're coming at me, but it's several pieces and there's several wants out there.
Yeah.
Yet the basics of making the town run effectively, you know, those pieces are yet to be put into place. So I think I just, you know, having that discussion with the different groups that want other things to happen is just my chance to kind of explain the thought process anyways.
Yeah.
Well, I do think it's great, Dave, that you're going to do the floors over at the Activity Center because they are in desperate need.
I think you even brought that up to me at a meeting at one point.
And 10 years later.
So don't lose track of what came first. You asked me about that before you asked me about the walking path. So
Yes. No, that was just a point of clarification, Dave. I needed some information. I'm not coming at you either, Dave.
Dave, what is the cost of the floors? Activity Center floors.
I just did, and I ran this past Josh Boynton. I got penciled in about $20,000, but it may not be. I can't remember exactly if the back two rooms are tile or whether they're wood floor. But I just simply took a square foot number, which is about $5.50 per square foot, and multiplied that by the 3,675 feet or whatever the first floor of the Activity Center is. And I came up with a number close to $20,000. So I don't think all of that square footage is wood floor, but you know, it was a close enough ballpark figure for me to put on paper and go from there.
Okay, well, I may ask you about that another time, what it's all about. We don't need to get into that tonight.
Dave, how about you mentioned the agreement with the North Hartland Dam is expiring this fiscal year. So what's the next step there?
So technically that's kind of an executive session question.
Oh, okay.
I don't think I'm
North Hartland.
I know there are two.
But let me just put it this way. With Jay Boeri, and who was already just assessed by the listers, we did the same with the Green Mountain Power Dam, I think out in North Hartland. And Doug, you may need to help me out here. There's a third dam out in North Hartland that has a separate agreement. The Green Mountain Power Dam had an agreement, and this dam has an agreement. We let the Green Mountain Power Dam contract lapse, and we're essentially going with an assessed value.
And that's correct. The Green Mountain Power Dam was recently purchased by Green Mountain Power, so we had a recent sale, we basically used that as a, we took that at face value, so they didn't disagree that's what it was worth, since they just bought it for that amount. We used a modified formula that the state asked us to use to come up with a value for the North Hartland Dam.
Doug, can you identify which one's which?
Yes. So the dam that runs with Army Corps of Engineers, the dam is what used to be White Current and is now Green Mountain Power.
Okay. I got it.
With a facility on Mills. So the a year from now. Let's see, that's going to be 22. In that time.
I'm not learning anything.
No, Doug, period. You're really breaking up. We can't understand it.
Say change from being through the terms. It's overdrive. It's too loud.
No, you're just breaking up to the point where we hear only a few of the words.
Gordon, it's the one that was.
I got it. That the Green Mountain Power is the one from the flood control.
The flood control dam is North Hartland LLC. The one by the covered bridge, Green Mountain Power.
Oh.
Yeah.
I'm totally wrong then.
I had an observation about assessments the other day as well, and I'm wondering what you think about this. The post office, the Pottery Barn, that building was listed for $1.5 million. But I looked at the property card and it was assessed at $5 million. And I know we had the recent round of reappraisals. I'm wondering, is there any sense that there's some sort of growing disconnect or something after that recent round of reappraisals, or what do you think about that?
Excuse me, Curtis, what did you just say that was assessed at? $5 million? Is that what you said?
No, Doug, I said the property was listed at $1.5 million. And I went and looked at the property card and I saw it was assessed at $500,000.
Okay, thank you.
So I'm just wondering I was like shocked to see that, right? And I don't anticipate that's the case everywhere, but from a revenue perspective, do you think there's any sort of disconnect growing between our appraisal and the real values? Dave?
So we won't know until we get the state report. Essentially the CLA kind of tells us where state sales are in relation to our appraisal. And after our last reappraisal, we were just slightly above one, which is where we want to be. One is like you're assessed correctly. We were just slightly above that. So, you know, we generally use that as a guide. If we get too far out of whack, you know, we would need to react to some degree. But being this short out after the reappraisal, it'll probably be a little bit before we revisit it. But the market is hot and people are buying and the lawyers are busy. Clyde can attest to that. So it's possible that the prices are up, but we'll know. Doug, that comes out in like January, right?
Yes, that's correct. Based on a rolling 3-year average. So that's one thing that Listerland is happy about, because prices are all over the place this year, all over the state. So it will average over 3 years for the CLA number.
I was just like shocked to see the listing price for the.
Well, I'll also say this is a seller's market right now, and people are coming out of the gate hot. Like, what the heck? Let's try this big fat number. Got nothing to lose. A lot of people from out of the area are buying property, and their sense of what the market value is different from those of us who live here, let's say. Or you're in a different strata of buildings. You know, the real high-end properties are in a different kind.
So I do want to just add one other thing. I had mentioned the market increase to myself and Martin, and this affects this year's budget more, but we're working within the budgeted amount for the listers. But with the new listers coming in, we did increase their salary to 20, as well as to coincide with that, for next fiscal year, Michelle will get a bump to kind of match that. It's not overly, you know, it's not too far off from where she is now, but that'll kind of align. And I know James is on the line here, but we also bumped the constable's amount by a couple dollars. That one was almost embarrassingly low for somebody doing what they do. It's still not all that high. But I used an average or what he had done for hours last year with this number, and it didn't come out too much higher than where we're at now. But again, I was using numbers that he's used in the, you know, hours that he's worked the past couple of years. But I didn't finish that conversation. I just wanted to finish it.
So I couldn't really understand from what Clyde was saying earlier today, continuing to speak about in like salaries for specific positions. What Clyde was really, it sounded like he was kind of dancing around the issue of that he was really trying to say for clerk salary. And so I won't dance around my thoughts on the issue. It would really, really suck for Brian to get 6 months of training and then get like snapped away in 6 months. That would really be a bummer. So I don't know exactly what that is at, but I just want to like say I hope that doesn't happen.
All I know is, you know, that his budget is in line with, you know, even got the cost of living increase there. Clyde put the budget together, and I didn't, you know, if I changed anything, it was maybe conferences, but I think I even kept the conferences the same, knowing that Brian may want to go to the amount that Clyde goes to, if not more. That kind of came from the clerk's office and really didn't get adjusted up or down.
Okay, so you didn't, for instance, look at the state averages to see if that was where that fell in line or anything?
No, I believe at this point in time, with the exception of a particular position, that we're pretty in line with the averages put forth by VLCT.
Well, you think we've been here long enough tonight? Well past the 90 minutes. If there's any more good comments or questions, sure would like to hear them, but. So we could call the budget part of the meeting over. Everyone's agreeable. And retire the people who aren't select persons and consider the Merrick Campbell request. Does that make
okay.
sense?
Okay.
Thank you, everybody.
Yeah. Have a good evening, everybody.
Thanks, everyone. Thanks,
Thank
Dave.
You, Doug.
Thank you. Bye. Good night.
Thank you,
Bill. Thank you, John. Thank you, Nancy. Thank you, Brian. Thank you, Clyde.
Thanks, Dave.
Thanks, Dave. Thanks, good night. Boy.
So how does recording work for these, Dave?
It doesn't. Okay. Did you guys officially adjourn, Gordon?
We didn't, and I was just thinking of that. Possibly before you turned off the camera, we ought to adjourn.
Yep.
So I'd take a motion for that.
I will move to adjourn.
You're not on, Phil.
I'll second the motion.
Thank you. I don't think we need to discuss it. Is everyone in favor?
Hi.
Still alive.
Good night. Martha and Mary, where are you?
Martha, I.
That's close to everyone.
The eyes have it.
Mary's gone.
Mary will be back. I assume.